Do you remember that 2004 version of Around the World in 80 Days?
You know, the one with the lame slapstick, the lame jokes, the lame sets and special effects and lame dumb characters.
Well, the people behind that film also made Wild Wild West.
This film has the exact same problems as that film, only it's even worse. But we're going to look at it.
It's a hard one to sit through, but I'm not gonna give up.
What?
It wasn't made by the same people?
It must have been! They look exactly the same.
Then, who made this one?
Barry Sonnenfeld, the director of Men in Black and the Addams Family?
Oh, well, my mistake then. Let's carry on. But first, let's look at a bit of history.
Wild Wild West was originally a TV series from 1965 that made the impossible by combining both spy and old western elements into one thing. Based on what I've read, it looks interesting. The premise sounds fun, the stories look unique, and so do the gadgets they use. Of course, Hollywood took this opportunity to adapt it into a feature film several decades later.
So let's finally review it. This is Wild Wild West.
The film is set in the Old West in 1869, and in our first scene, we see...
He's a madman! A giant spider!
And they say you scientists are supposed to be smart.
Great! First we have a weird and confusing scene, and then we cut to a piece of shit joke! We're off to a great start! We then cut to Will Smith playing an undercover agent called Jim West. He's having sex with not Rosario Dawson as he spots a bunch of men smuggling items. Wait, play that again please.
Oh my! A few more seconds and this film would be rated R.
Shiny!
There's no point in hiding it, we've already seen it!
Smith follows the remaining smugglers to a saloon, where we meet Artemis Gordon, played by Kevin Kline. Possibly wearing the most unconvincing disguise I have ever seen in film.
50 cents.
I'm very flattered, but I'm just not interested.
But I love men in drag!
I may be a whore, but I work alone.
Kline tries to get information out of a war criminal with the use of... hypno boobs.
What? If this film can make bad puns, I have a right to make up my own.
Smith accidentally interrupts the hypnotizing, resulting in a fight.
US Army, stay out of my way, lady!
Not a lady, I'm a US Marshal! Stay out of my way!
Now what?
Wow! How will they get out of that situation?
What? Don't tell me that we've just skipped an important scene. The saloon blows up and it just immediately cuts to Washington DC. Did they run out of money for that scene?
Actually, how much did this film cost to make? I need to know. Maybe it costs 50 million, 70 million, 80...
$170 million?! How the fuck does this film look like it was made with $170 million? I've seen other films with better production values that cost a lot less. Or did they spend most of it on the actors to make sure they wouldn't run away from the film after reading the script? Back with the film. Smith goes to the Capitol to speak with President Grant and... Oh! Hello again, Kevin Kline. Why are you dressed as the president?
Except maybe the impulsive actions of a headstrong cowboy.
Who are you, mister?
What do you mean, who am I? I am the President of the United States.
No. That's Kevin Kline in another bad disguise.
I am the President. I'm Artemis Gordon. How did you know?
Oh! We were actually supposed to be fooled by it. How rude of me.
After that pointless scene, We do see the actual president, who informs them both about the disappearance of several scientists.
All kidnapped in the last year, and all by General McGrath. You two have been working on the same case the whole time.
Well, sir, because one of us was trying to catch McGrath and the other was trying to marry him.
Look, you two are the best I've got.
Really? These two are the best agents you have? What? Are the other agents dumber that they can't think for more than 5 seconds?
Smith and Klein embark on Klein's special train and... Is it me? Or was this train made by the Looney Tunes?
If this were a cartoon, the cliff would break off now.
The two decide to analyze the corpse of the scientist from scene 1 to see if they can find a clue.
That's a man's head.
Indeed, Will.
That's a man's head.
Thank you, Will. You didn't have to remind me again.
That's a man's head.
Well, stop repeating it. The audience already knows what it is.
That is a man's.
We get it! It's a man's head! It's not even a joke! And repeating it doesn't make it funny!
They find a clue leading to a party that will be hosted by Dr. Lovelace. So they decide to go there. With the action about to start, it's time to watch some hilarious chemistry between these two.
These breasts are a work of art. Aesthetically and scientifically perfect.
They look like shit.
Touch them.
Are you happy, Gordon? I'm touching your breasts.
I knew it.
Wait, squeeze it gently.
Not that hard. Now touch my breast.
Ooh.
Huh? Now that's what a breast is supposed to feel like.
Very nice.
Now touch yourself.
Oh my god, I'm hard.
Or maybe they can just resort to lazy boob jokes.
How about this? You can come as my manservant.
Oh, why yes, sir, Master Gordon. Oh, I swears I'd be delighted. I'll sing, I'll dance for you, sir. Oh, and I swears none of the other white folks will know I'd rather shoot myself than play your damn manservant.
By the way, these two have no chemistry whatsoever. None, at all. Their interactions consist of guy number one saying a few words, while guy number two waits for guy number one to stop talking just so he can say some words that may or may not have anything to do with what guy number one said. The two split up to infiltrate the party, where we finally meet Dr. Lovelace.
Don't you just hate that song?
Yeah. Apparently, he lost his legs during the war and rides a steampunk wheelchair. And believe it or not, he's actually played by British actor Kenneth Branagh.
I will not be sworn, but love may transform me to an oyster.
Just listen to his imitation at an American accent.
Why, y'all look like you've seen a ghost.
I haven't seen him in a coon's age.
Rita is sleeping off the after effects in the stateroom.
Bloodbath McGrath, indeed.
Does it sound convincing?
See anybody that looks familiar?
Matter of fact, I do.
Let me guess. That's a real woman. That's a real woman. That's a real woman. That's a real woman. That's a real woman.
You're in for a big surprise when you get this one in the saddle.
Stupid cowboy, eh? You mistake you for me.
How did I see that joke coming?
By the way, boobies look great tonight, nice and perky.
Oh. Hang him!
Wow, people were very serious about women's rights back then. While everyone is busy trying to hang Smith, Klein sneaks into a room where he finds a stripper named Rita, played by Selma Hayek in the middle of a Robert Rodriguez production.
There you are.
Thank you. Artemis, was it?
It was.
Meanwhile, Smith is doing, I don't know, last words before execution.
Then there was the redneck comment, and I'm getting a sense that y'all took that negatively. But let's break down that word. Redneck. First word, red. Color of passion. fire, power, second word, neck. Neck. All right, I can't think of anything for neck right now, but without it, y'all still got red, and that's something to be really proud of.
The three escape the party, and they board the train to find Rita's father.
My name is Rita Escobar. I came to find Guillermo Escobar, the scientist, my father.
Let's go, Coleman, Utah.
Aye, sir.
Now it's time for women to do something important in this film, to prove that they're just as important as men.
I told you she'd be a distraction.
She's not a distraction. It's nice having her on board. She's a breath of fresh ass.
Why do I keep hoping that this film will improve? I feel betrayed.
Disappointed!
The next day, they are ambushed by Dr. Lovelace.
I'd rather be dead!
That's not a good thing to wish for!
Oh, please, Artie, don't leave me alone! It's Lovelace,
Gordon,
it's a dream!
Open the door.
Yes, it is!
Jim.
What a lame way to be defeated. She was just as useless as a bridge made out of used handkerchiefs.
Come on in, gentlemen. I trust you slept well. What a marvelous train. You don't mind me borrowing it, do you, gentlemen?
Lovelace takes Rita as hostage, leaving Smith and Klein with one of his weapons, which actually looks like a sex toy.
The gully!
You can clearly see that the blades are faster than the two. Then, how come they never seem to catch them up? Every time they're closer, the camera turns away, and they're further away than before. Are they like the angels in Doctor Who? Except this time they only move when we're looking at them.
No, no, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to make you suffer. I'm going to make you scream like a pig.
No!
Oh, come on! Don't you dare shut your eyes because I'm gonna-
No!
Oh, come on! I warned you!
No!
Oh, okay, fuck this! Why can't none of my victims keep their eyes open? Every time they shut their eyes, I go backwards. That's it, I give up being a serial killer. Fuck this at all!
Sorry, man.
They avoid the blades and manage to find Lovelace's secret hideout, where they discover his secret weapon.
No! Look, I'm going to close my eyes, okay? My eyes are closed now, okay? And when I open them, whatever I just saw on screen, I want it out of the film, okay? There! It's gone! No!
Even for a film that has dudes disguised as women, inventions made by Acme, boob jokes, and half a man in a wheelchair, this is very fucking stupid! This is not just jumping the shark, people. This is jumping the entire universe in one go.
He has an 80-foot tarantula. Yes, well, I was coming to that. Nice to see an invention that actually works.
Most impressive.
I know they're supposed to be surprised and speechless, but they sound kind of bored.
That thing will never get past those rocks.
Oh, a giant spider. I guess that's kind of normal.
Not far from where they are, Grant is opening a railway line where he finally sees the spider.
Oh, come on! How could they not see that miles away? That thing is huge! What the hell? Did everyone just abandon their president?
So long, Mr. President! We are leaving you alone so you can make a peace treaty with that giant spider that for some reason we didn't see it coming until it was 100 meters away.
fact, I'm Dr. Arliss Lovelace, formerly of the Confederate Army.
What can I do for you today? In matters pertaining to war, the person to talk to would be me. This man is an actor hired to stand in for me on public...
No. Skip that.
Is this part of your plan, Gordon?
Well, I'm by your side, sir.
Dead! Oh wait, I forgot. This film doesn't seem to be set in real reality, so he's probably alive. Lovelace takes Grant and Klein to his hideout, where he reveals his evil plan.
United! Divided!
Little piece for me to retire on.
Oh no! This also means that the entire world will be taken over by giant spiders. We're all doomed! Will Smith, being the only one left, organizes a plan to free everyone and- Okay! You're not even trying, movie! You're not even trying! Yeah! Go back to that old unfunny gag that you've repeated for over 50 times in this film! If this scene was the least bit realistic, it would have been like...
That is Jim West! Get him!
He is quickly discovered, duh, but manages to defeat the soldiers with... Fire boobs! Holy shit! I think I've just discovered a new fashion trend. Fire coming out of people's breasts. I mean, think about it. Wouldn't that look great? But Lovelace escapes with the president on the spider. Damn it, Will, you had one job! Smith and Klein use a fucking plane to try and get onto the spider.
Gordon!
Just kidding. They do manage to fly. They land on the spider, only to be captured again. They're the best in getting captured. Now Lovelace can finally kill them. You sent him to the machine room? Are you fucking stupid? Now he can do, I don't know, destroy the machine? Will Smith fights some men who look like rejected first drafts of Dr. Frankenstein's monster.
Nice hat.
Do I even need to explain it? That scene just summed up the film's laziness. But Lovelace rides another spider to kill Will. But it's immediately destroyed by the shot of one bullet. I used to think Lovelace was a clever villain. But with his latest dumb actions, he's just as dumb as everyone else. In fact, it's not even Will or Klein who destroy his giant spider, but himself!
For axle grease!
The two hold on to each other to avoid falling into the green screen effect.
Well, how did we arrive in this dark situation?
I have no idea, Dr. Lovelace. I'm just as stumped as you are.
On the one hand, I have the overwhelming love I have for myself, and on the other, the raw, seething hatred that I have for you. Now, I could kill you very easily, Mr. West, just by pulling on this lever, but I would die along with you, hence my conflict.
Just kill yourselves! It's not worth carrying on living for this film. How will Smith get out of there? Or we can just skip it. Yeah, the sooner it's over, the better. Smith and Klein save the day, and Selma Hayek, who you forgot was in the film, appears.
I just wanted to thank you for everything that you've done for me before I went back home to Texas.
Texas? Why are you going back to Texas?
What do you mean?
I was thinking maybe you'd come back to Washington with me.
Professor Escobar is not my father. He's my husband.
What?
You could have told us that from the beginning, Rita.
Yes.
Rita, dear, we really must be going.
At least you still have each other.
Why did she say that her husband was her father? What was the point of that plot twist? In fact, why was she in the film in the first place? You could have cut her out and it wouldn't have made a difference. Well, except for the ass jokes, but you get the point.
But me and Artemis Cloud Frog still have to do our love scene with Sam Hayek.
Jim?
What now, Artie?
Mind if I ask you a question?
Actually, I do, Artie.
Written by someone who had no idea how to end a story. Ugh, this was awful! The jokes are unfunny, the characters are stupid and unlikable, the acting is non-existent, there's zero character development, the plot is badly put together, and a big waste of $170 million. And what's worst of all is that this film was in development for 7 years and had 6 writers. 7 years and 6 writers, and not one of them realized all this time that they were writing a piece of shit. I haven't seen the show, but from what I've read, the film is not very faithful. I am a standard critic, and thanks for watching. Step in front.